If you've ever tried using DaVinci Resolve on Linux, then you've probably encountered the problem with importing videos in MP4 and MOV formats. These containers are often used for videos encoded with H.264 and H.265, which are two of the most popular video codecs used by streaming platforms like YouTube, Twitch, or Odyssey. Now, when you take a look at the list of formats and codecs that are supported in DaVinci Resolve for Linux, you'll notice that both of these codecs are only available in the paid studio version. But even if you buy a license for the studio version, you still won't be able to import audio encoded with AAC, which is often used together with H.264 and H.265 videos. To fix that, today I'm going to show you how you can convert your videos to supported formats using FFmpeg commands, and how I simplify this process with a simple bash script. And by the way, I'll leave timestamps in the comments in case YouTube breaks chapters like in my first video, so if you're only interested in a specific part, feel free to skip ahead. And now, let's get right into it. To convert our videos, we're going to use the FFmpeg utility. You can verify if FFmpeg is installed on your system by opening a terminal window and typing which FFmpeg. If your output looks like this, then you're good to go, and if not, you can install FFmpeg with your distribution's package manager. Now, let's go over some commands that you can use to convert your videos. The first command takes the file input.mp4, then it changes its video codec to DNxHR HQ and the audio codec to 16-bit PCM, and finally it saves the converted video as output.mov. If you want to use 10-bit color depth, consider using the second command instead, which uses DNxHR HQX profile. The next few commands use AV1 as the output codec and save the video in an MP4 container. You might want to adjust both the preset and CRF values depending on your personal needs. Basically, the higher the preset value, the less time it will take to complete the conversion, but the size of the output file will also be larger. And the lower you set the CRF value, the better quality you will get. Generally speaking, 23 is usually considered to be visually lossless, but using lower CRF values will also take much more time for video to convert. With -G argument, you basically set how often an iframe will be inserted into your video. And you can also specify pixel format to use 10-bit color depth. If you're an actual psychopath, you can also use the last command, which uses AOM encoder. This one basically gives you the option of lossless encoding. Running this command will take so much time that not even your kids might be able to see the final video, so you should probably listen to the cow and just stick to the ones above. And finally, the last two commands convert the input video to MPEG 4 Part 2 codec. This argument right here allows you to set the quality value for the output video. The lower number you use, the better quality you get, but it also increases the file size. If you wonder which command you should use, I'll talk about pros and cons of using each encoder later on in the video, so don't worry about it for now. This is great and all, but you probably don't want to manually type these commands every time you want to convert a video. So now I'm going to show you how I simplify this process with a bash script. Before I show you the script itself, I'm going to demonstrate to you how it works. I have two videos right here. The first one has been encoded with H.264 video and AAC audio, and the second video is using H.265 for video and AAC for audio as well. So now when I go to DaVinci Resolve and try to import these files, you'll notice that we don't get any thumbnail previews for these videos. Now, when I click on any of these files, go to the Inspector tab and select the file, you'll notice that the video codec is not even detected, which honestly is a bit weird because the audio codec gets detected even though it's also not supported in the free version. But regardless, if I now grab both of these files and put them into my timeline, you'll see that the video track is still empty and there isn't any audio data right here. The mixer also doesn't show any audio output. So to fix this, I'm going to go back to my file manager, select both of these files and drop them into convert queue directory. You can see that my waybar module is now telling me that I have two video files queued for conversion. I'm going to open this folder, click F3 on my keyboard to open the split view, and in the second pane I'm going to open converted directory, which is where the converted videos will be placed. Now I'm going to navigate to that waybar module and click on it to invoke my script. As you can see, the script gives me three options to choose from, and since I want to convert videos that use unsupported codecs, I'm going to press 1 on my keyboard. Now the script gives me three video codecs to choose from. I'm going to select AV1 by pressing 2, and as you can see, the videos are now being converted one by one. As each video gets processed, I get a desktop notification telling me how many files are left in the queue. Once the conversion is completed, I also get a final notification. As you can see, the videos have been successfully re-encoded. Both of them are using AV1 and PCM right now. So let's go back to DaVinci Resolve and try importing these newly created files. I'm going to open the converted directory, select both of these files and drag them into DaVinci Resolve. You can already see that we get thumbnail previews, so it's already a good sign. And now if I select any of these videos, you can see that codec metadata is displaying correctly. And now let's select both of these files and drop them into my timeline. And as you can see, everything works now. You can see that the audio is playing as well. So that's great, but when you go to the delivery page and try browsing through different formats and codecs, you'll see that there is no option for H.264 and H.265. This might be a problem if you want to upload your videos to YouTube, which recommends you to use codecs that aren't supported in the free version at all. So what I would do next is export my video in DNxHR, then once again place the video in convert queue directory, and then I would invoke my script once again. This time I would select the second option, and this time I get to pick between H.264, H.265, and AV1. So yeah, this is basically it. And now let's take a look at the code. All right, so now I'm going to go over the script step by step and explain what's actually going on behind the scenes. I would also like to let you know that I'm not a programmer, so you might notice some redundancy here. If you have any ideas on how this script could be improved, feel free to post them in the comments, and you might just help someone who comes across this video in the future. Anyway, first I set some variables. Media in is a folder where you put videos that you want to convert. Media out is path to directory where converted videos will be placed. Total is just the number of videos that are in the input folder. Then icons dir is just the directory where my icons for desktop notifications are. Icon success is the default icon, and icon error is an icon that displays when you get an error. Then I define some simple functions for sending desktop notifications so that I don't have to retype this entire command too many times. Then I just echoed this simple selection menu and made a simple case statement that displays codec selection menu based on the user choice. So if the user enters one, which means that they want to import an incompatible video to DaVinci Resolve, then I set acceptable input codecs as H.264 and HEVC, which is just another name for H.265. And then, based on the selected codec, I set relevant FFmpeg arguments, as well as an output format for the video. Now, if the user selects the second option, which means that they want to convert a video that they just exported from DaVinci Resolve, I set input codecs as DNxHD and Apple ProRes, and then the script asks you to pick a video codec. And once again, depending on your choice, it sets relevant FFmpeg arguments. Once the arguments are set, the script basically does some minor checks. So first it checks whether FFmpeg is installed on your system. If it's not, then it will exit and tell you to install it. Then it creates both media in and media out directories in case they don't already exist. And finally, it checks if there are any videos in the input folder. And now we almost get to encoding. So I set file index variable as 0. This is only for the counter in the desktop notifications. And then we have a for loop. So for each file in the input directory, we first set additional variables for each video file. File name is the name of the file without the extension, like .mp4 or .mov. Container format is the second part of the file's MIME type. Video and audio codec are pretty self-explanatory. They are fetched using ffprobe against the files. The same goes for the frame rate. And keyframe interval is just the value of frame rate multiplied by 10. Now, this is where I know redundancy kicks in, but I didn't know any other way of how to achieve that. So if the user selected AV1 as the output codec, we basically update the FFmpeg arguments based on the file's frame rate. Then we basically set file extension of the input video based on its MIME type. So for MP4, it's .mp4. For QuickTime, it's .mov, and so on. Then we check if the audio codec of the file is AAC. If it is, then we convert it to 16-bit PCM. And if it's not, we just copy it, because Resolve shouldn't have any issues with any other audio codecs. I would like to eventually change this part, because if you select the option of rendering the final video, then the recommended codec would be either AAC or Opus, but this is fine if you just want to import videos to DaVinci Resolve. And finally, we check whether the file's video codec matches with the input codecs that we set previously. If it does, then we update the file index, send a desktop notification, and finally convert the video with FFmpeg. You can see that I execute this command in a terminal because it allows me to see the progress, but if you don't need that, you can just remove this part. And finally, once every file has been converted, we get this desktop notification that says conversion finished. So yeah, this script was basically my idea on how to tackle this codec problem in DaVinci Resolve without going insane and opening my terminal every second time. So like I said, if you have any ideas on how this script could be improved, let me know down in the comments. And now let's talk about video codecs. With so many different codecs to choose from, you might be wondering which one is best for your workflow. Using each encoder has its own pros and cons, so let's take a quick look at each one to help you decide. First, let's talk about DNxHR. DNxHR is a high-quality intraframe codec, meaning it stores each frame as a complete image. This makes it a great choice for video editing, as it allows for smooth playback and easily scrubbing through your footage. It also supports up to 12-bit color depth. And finally, encoding videos with DNxHR is relatively fast. On the downside, DNxHR files take up a huge amount of disk space, with even short videos easily taking up gigabytes of storage. Now, let's take a look at AV1. AV1 is a modern, highly efficient video codec, which can achieve up to 50% better compression than H.264. As such, it's a good choice if you want to keep your past projects with the option to tweak them later without consuming too much disk space. It also supports 10-bit color depth, giving you better color precision. And as for the drawbacks, AV1 encoding is a very time-consuming process, which might even take hours depending on the length of your video and the quality settings you choose. And also because of its high compression, it utilizes a lot of your system resources. So if your machine is not powerful enough, you might want to generate additional proxy media in a different format, which will take additional time. And finally, let's talk about MPEG 4 Part 2. Encoding with this codec is fast, and the file size of created videos is smaller than DNxHR, but larger than AV1. The downside is that MPEG 4 Part 2 is an older codec that isn't widely used anymore, and it lacks some features found in modern codecs like H.264 and H.265. In fact, it is so old that we can now use it on Linux because its patents have expired. So I'll take that as a win, I guess. So these were the key advantages and drawbacks of using each codec. I hope this helps you choose the right one for your workflow. I also did a simple test comparing these various encoders. Basically, I've just run this script that you can see on the left. It took the same input video and then it converted it using various encoders. Before and after running each FFmpeg command, it also made a timestamp. Here you can see the output from running this script. And I also made a simple data table. So as you can see, DNxHD and MPEG 4 encoders are the fastest, but they also produce the largest file size. And AV1 is the slowest encoder of them all, but you can see that it also produces the smallest file size. So yeah, it was just a simple test, you know, don't take it as any kind of benchmarks. It's more like a bro science, but you know, I just wanted to showcase you the differences. And if you want to see an actual comparison of various AV1 encoding settings, I encourage you to check out the Otterverse article from the description of this video. I will also put links to interesting articles from FFmpeg Wiki, so feel free to check it out if you want to learn more about this topic. Anyway, thank you for watching this video. I hope you found it helpful, and I'll see you guys in the next one.